to provide men sustainable development, life full of health, happiness and humanity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for delivering a thought-provoking and inspiring talk by providing an overview and comprehensive account of medicinal plants found not only in India, also in Rajasthan. He also pointed out the need of the conservation of biodiversity and also explained the methods of the preservation and conservation of the biodiversity. Thank you very much. So, in continuation of presentation is by the Anita Chauhan. The title of the presentation is Antimicrobial Activity of Verbenia encephaloides, a medicinally important plant of a region. And I would like to request to all of the presenters, please restrict to your presentation 10 minutes because of the constraint of the time, 5 or maybe for the question 3 or 4 minutes. So I invite Anita Chauhan for her presentation.
Respected chairpersons, teachers and my dear friends, today I am here to present my research work under the supervision of Dr. Shilpi Rizwani. My topic is Antimicrobial Activity of Verbenia encephaloides, a medicinally important plant of the Arizona. Introduction. In the recent years, research on medicinal plants has attracted a lot of attention globally. Large body of evidence has accumulated to demonstrate the promising potential of medicinal plants used in various traditional complementary and alternative systems of treatment of human disease. Next. As we know that plants are rich in wide variety of secondary metabolites such as tannins, terpenoids, alkaloids, flavonoids, etc., which have been found in vitro to have antimicrobial properties. The arid zone of Rajasthan has its own importance and specific characteristics with respect to endemic and a large number of plants of economic importance and medicinal use. Researches on medicinal plants of the arid zone indicate that a large number of them primarily contains alkaloids. Second, the essential oils constitute the second group of the constituents of the plant of the arid regions. The aim of the present study is to establish the antimicrobial capacity of this arid zone plant of family Asteraceae. As we know that Asteraceae is also known as compositae and it commonly referred to as the aster, daisy or sunflower family. It makes one of the two largest flowering plant families in the world. The present work involves an antimicrobial capacity of this arid zone plant Verbenia encephaloides. Verbenia encephaloides, commonly known as golden crown bear, it is a noxious weed and it shows aggressive and dominant growth abilities. My objectives are to collect healthy plants and confirm them from voucher specimen in the herbarium department of Botany, University of Rajasthan, to analyze physiochemical constituent of the plant, to study the antimicrobial activity of the crude extract of the plant by agar diffusion method and MIC. Significance. Research on medicinal plants should be focused primarily on species whose pharmaceutical activities have already been demonstrated. The present study is designed to provide scientific evidence for its use as a traditional folk remedy by investigation the phytochemical constituent of the plant as well as the antibacterial activity. The essential soils would be evaluated for antimicrobial activity against the gram-positive bacteria and gram-negative bacteria strains obtained from leading hospitals and the labs of Jaipur City. Now methodology. First, identification and the collection of the plant material. The collection of the plant material, the collection of the selected plant parts like stem, leaves and the flowers, these was done. And after that, the material was drying and crushed to form a powder foam. That the collection of the plant sample extract was done by using Soxhlet apparatus, passing through various solvent according to their polarity from non-polar to polar, like N-hexane, ethyl acetate, chloroform, methanol and water. After that, the fresh crude extract was screened to physicochemical analysis of by qualitative and quantitative tests. These are the qualitative estimation tests for various carbohydrates, proteins, amino acids, tannins, flavonoids and saponins. And after the qualitative and quantitative estimation, the antimicrobial activity of the crude extract was done by agar diffusion test and MIC. These are the qualitative analysis of various extract of Verbena anchyloides. These tables shows the presence of various alkaloids, flavonoids, saponins and the tannin present and absence shows in various solvents. The test shows the this is the photos of shows the presence and absence of various secondary metabolites. After that, the results of antimicrobial activity of whole plant of Verbena anchyloides in various extract of the solvent. In I have selected total 5 microorganism gram positive and gram bacteria. This is the table shows that the ethyl acetate extract and the methanol extract shows antimicrobial activity against selected microorganisms. This is the results of antimicrobial activity of selected microorganisms. Conclusion: based on the above results, it is concluded that the crude extract of the plant in various solvents, these were found to be very effective against selected ATC strains. So, such screening of various natural organic compounds and the identification of the active agents is the need of the hour of the successful predictions of the drug development. Thank you.
So now the presentation is open for question, one or two questions. Speaker Neha Sharma, the title of the presentation is Microbial Diversity Study based on culture dependent and culture independent approach. So now we shift to a little bit to the microbial diversity from the higher plant diversity.
They are being evaluated, so they are requested to move to the hall where they are being. Welcome to one and all. I am Neha Sharma, and restricting to the theme that is biodiversity, I shall be speaking a little about microbial diversity studies based on culture dependent and culture independent approach. It is just an overview. Now, to introduce this microbial diversity, we all know that microorganisms are ubiquitous in nature. They are present in almost every environment, be it abiotic or biotic. And the most promising feature of these microorganisms is that their role has been established in geochemical nutrient cycles. And to be precise enough, I shall be focusing on microorganisms in wastewater treatment and their bioremediation potential. Now, what is the significance of microbial diversity? This is a question which comes in our mind and is being talked about since times. Now, as we all know that culture-dependent techniques are not that promising enough when we speak of microbial diversity, because only 1% of microbes that we study or that we know are actually culturable. 99% of diversity is still hidden. And for this 99% of fraction, we use the term black box. So, need of the hour is to unlock this black box through culture-independent techniques. There are two main elements of diversity, that is richness and evenness of species. Microorganisms undoubtedly represent the richest repertoire of molecular and chemical diversity in nature. Now, this is a polyphasic approach for analysis of microbial diversity as devised by Jain et al. Microbial diversity, as I had already mentioned, is being studied under two categories. One is the culture-dependent approach, in which we have to restrict ourselves to the wet lab. And another approach is the culture-independent methods, that is entirely based on molecular biology techniques. Now, methods to study microbial diversity again are based upon two main important factors, that is the culture dependent and the culture independent. The culture dependent factors basically deal with isolation and identification of microbes through conventional microbiology techniques, and identification is based upon the phenotypic characters. Now, why do we opt for molecular methods in particular? Because, as I had already mentioned, that 99% of diversity is still hidden, and to unlock this black box, we need to go for some culture independent or molecular based methods. Now, these 99% of microbes which are yet to be explored are viable but non-culturable. Now, this is the most important factor which we need to work upon. In culture independent approaches, primarily we have genetic fingerprinting techniques, and 16S rDNA sequencing is one of the most important factors in this. Then we have terminal restriction fragment length polymorphism. Then we have ARDRA and denaturing gel gradient electrophoresis, which is an important tool for community dynamic studies. Then we have DNA microarray, fluorescent in situ hybridization, and metagenomics approach. Now, why 16S rDNA sequencing is important? The most important feature of 16S rDNA sequencing is that 16S fragment, the ribosomal fragment is known as the molecular chronometer or evolutionary clock, because it is the most conserved region which is carried throughout the course of evolution, and quantitative estimation says that almost 10,000 to 1 lakh ribosomes per cell are present. The most important feature of 16S rDNA sequencing is the exploitation of marker gene, in which we have some universal primers so that identity could be found out. Now, this is the multidisciplinary approach which suggests that from an environmental sample, how the diversity could be studied utilizing both culture dependent and culture independent approaches. The dotted line here represents the fluorescent in situ hybridization techniques and DNA probes. Now, the applied aspect of microbial diversity, an eco-friendly alternative to combat pollution, that is biodegradation of xenobiotics, which is my current area of research. In this, I had made a mention that wastewater treatment plant is a model ecosystem in which the autochthonous microflora or the indigenous microflora could be studied based upon their the diversity, and bioprospecting could be carried out for the particular pollutant of interest, and further bioremediation, biodegradation, or to be very precise, the biotransformation techniques could be exploited for the biodegradation of xenobiotics. Now, what are the future insights in this particular microbial diversity? Bacterial diversity of an environmental sample, example the wastewater. Community dynamics, as I had already mentioned, could be studied. Then marker genes could be further exploited for identity. Then functional genes, some enzymatic mechanisms which are underlying for the biodegradation of xenobiotics. Then concludingly, metabolic profile and the biodegradative studies. Now, these are the references from which I had taken my text. Thank you.
Now the presentation is open for discussion or questions, if you have any one or two questions, very fast. If there is no questions, thank you very much for giving an overview and what is the importance of the molecular tools and polyphasic approach in the exploring the microbial diversity.
Thank you.
So the next speaker is Gayatri Joseph. The title is Isolation and Growth Studies of Biosurfactant Producing Bacterial Isolate.
Namaskar. I am Gayatri Jha, presenting a paper entitled as Isolation and Growth Studies on Biosurfactant Producing Isolate. Next. We start with introduction. Surfactants are molecules that concentrate at interfaces and decrease surface and interfacial tensions. These compounds are widely used in industries like, for example, emulsification, foaming and detergency. Next. Almost all the chemical surfactants are derived from petroleum. Naturally occurring surfactants are derived from microorganisms such as bacteria, yeast and fungi. Which are known as biosurfactants. Biosurfactants are amphiphilic compounds which either adhere to cell surface or excreted extracellularly in the growth medium. Objective of our study was isolation and study growth conditions for biosurfactant producing bacteria. Next. Methodology of our study was as following. First of all, we collected samples from oil contaminated and uncontaminated sites. Then bacteria were isolated from these samples. Then we screened isolated bacteria for biosurfactant production. Then we growth studies were carried out. Next. Bacterial growth was estimated by measurement of absorbance at wavelength of 540 nanometer, and biosurfactant producing bacteria were screened on the basis of hemolytic activity. The best isolate in terms of clearing zone was used for further studies. Next. For growth studies, the isolate was grown in minimal media, M9, which supplemented with various carbon sources and nitrogen sources. Various carbon sources such as glucose, glycerol, starch and N-hexadecane was used to verify the effect of carbon source on growth of bacterial isolate, and various nitrogen sources such as ammonium nitrate, sodium nitrate, ammonium chloride were used to verify the effect of nitrogen sources on bacterial growth. To assess optimum temperature, the bacteria were subjected to various temperature from 4 degrees centigrade to 60 degrees Celsius. And to assess optimum pH, the bacteria were subjected to various pH from 3 to 10. Next. Then results of our study were as following. This slide shows the growth of bacterial isolate on Luria agar. It was identified as Penibacillus dendritiformis. Next. Then we studied, then glycerol was best carbon source for optimum bacterial growth among other carbon sources. Next. And ammonium nitrate was best nitrogen source for optimum bacterial growth. Next. 37 degrees Celsius was best temperature for bacterial growth. Next. And pH of 7 was optimum for bacterial growth. Next. Then we conclude that ammonium nitrate was best nitrogen source and glycerol was best carbon source, and 37 degrees Celsius temperature and pH of 7 was optimum for bacterial growth. Next. I would like to acknowledge UGC for providing me financial support, and Dr. Ashok Gupta, my supervisor, Dr. Shruti Mathur. Thanking you for listening me.
Thank you, Kamakshi. No, not today. Right. Next is me. So you, the sentence is open for question. I have one question. How you identified that there is a species level? You did it, but you have not. To beja, but before. Thank you. So, now thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So now I invite The next speaker, Kamakshi Tomar, Jasminium grandiflorum, a novel antifungal agent against Candida tropicalis.
I am Kamakshi Tomar from the IIS University and my topic is Jasminum grandiflorum, a novel antifungal agent against Candida tropicalis. As we all know that the nature has provided an important source of remedies to cure all the ailment of medicines of mankind, all plant contains hundreds of secondary metabolites, which you can say those are the phytomedicines, and the substance which can either inhibit the growth or either kill the microorganism and have least toxicity to host cells are considered for developing new antifungal drugs. And it is always believed that the crude extract of the plants are more biologically active because of the synergistic effect. Thus, it is anticipated that the crude extract with adequate antifungal efficacy will be used for the treatment of various fungal diseases. As we all know that the fungus is a primitive widespread microorganism which can easily infect plant as well as animals. Fungal infections are estimated to occur in over a billion of people and the percentage is increasing day by day. Some fungus are associated with animal and human as a commensals, but it turn pathogenic or opportunistic after alteration of the host immune system. And such kind of alteration we can see in immunosuppressive patients where the use of broad spectrum antibiotics in various clinical conditions and other predisposing factors are responsible for increasing the fungal infections. A weakened or impaired immune system provides favorable condition for pathogenic as well as non-pathogenic microorganism to grow fungal infections. The objective of my study is to investigate the antifungal activity of Jasminum grandiflorum plant, which is commonly known as chameli, in view to its diverse pharmacological application in ancient as well as modern system of medicine. And this work is focused on Jasminum grandiflorum plant for their antifungal activity against a fungus that is Candida tropicalis, which is a major causing organism of candidiasis. The plant which we are using for this study is Jasminum grandiflorum, which is related to Oleaceae family, and all parts of the plant includes leaves, stem, bark, as well as flowers are used for a pharmaceutical purpose. Jasminum plant traditionally used as aphrodisiac, antibiotic as well as antifungal treatment, and we all know that the fresh juice of leaves are applied to corn and leaves are chewed and used in the treatment of ulceration during ulceration of the mouth. And the leaves contain so many secondary metabolites, those are resin, salicylic acid and alkaloid, which is jasmine. Now, first of all, we should know that what is oral candidiasis. The Candida species, which are commonly grown in human as a best pathogen, which can be altered in opportunistic infection, and this shows immunocompromised host patient, AIDS sufferer, cancer patients. Infections are very difficult to treat and almost 30-40% patients are dead because of this infection. Oral candidiasis is a candidiasis that occur in mouth in mucous membrane, and Candida albicans causes 50% of death, and when it combines with Candida tropicalis, the death rate increase 80%. Now, oral candidiasis can be classified into two categories: group 1, primary oral candidiasis, and group 2, which is secondary oral candidiasis. Primary oral candidiasis is again categorized into four categories, which is pseudomembranous, which is acute or chronic. Second one is erythromitis, which is acute or chronic. Hyperplasmia, in which plaque-like or nodular-like structure formed. And the fourth one is Candida, which is associated with lesion. Then secondary or oral candidiasis, which is oral manifestation of systematic neurocutaneous candidiasis. Now, how to cause candidiasis? Small amount of Candida, which is a fungus already present in our mouth and in our digestive tract or skin, is mostly very fruitful for us, but they are normally kept in check by some another microorganism like bacteria in the body. But when there is some illness, stress or medicines, it disturbs the delicate balance of microorganism, and the fungus causing the infections in terms of candidiasis or oral thrush. Now the material and methods. First of all, the plant material was collected and plant extract was prepared by using succinate extraction in various solvent, that is hexane, chloroform, ethyl acetate, methanol and water. Then that plant extract was tested against clinically originated fungus, which is Candida tropicalis, which were taken from the Department of Microbiology, Mahatma Gandhi Medical Institute, Health and Research Center, Jaipur. The fungus was grown on a chrome agar media at 37 degree centigrade and it was maintained on nutrient agar slant at 4 degree centigrade. Fungus inoculum was prepared by taking a loop of isolated colonies and inoculated into 4 ml of peptone water, and that was compared with a McFarlane reagent standard. Then a sterile cotton swab was dipped into the fungal suspension and it is evenly streaked over the entire surface of MHA media. Then antifungal activity of jasmine and grandifolium extract were evaluated by this diffusion method and placed inoculated with test organism were incubated at 37 degree centigrade for 24 hours, and the results, the diameter of zone of inhibition is measured, if any, around the well were measured in mm. The all experiments were carried out in the terms of triplet and solvents used as a mother solvent which is already used. Then the result and discussion. The result obtained in the present investigation is that the sample number 23, 24, 26, 27, 29 and 30 sample were showing highest activity against the fungus which is Candida tropicalis. These are my results, in which you can say in sample 23 I have got the zone of inhibition which is 15 mm, sample 24 9 mm, 10 mm, 13, 11 and 14 mm. The further conclusion is the crude extract of the plant in various solvents were found to be effective against some selected fungus. If the inhibitory activity of plant extract is largely depend on the concentration, if we increase the concentration, the inhibitory activity is also increased. And for further studies, the synergistic effect of some known antibiotic can be compared with the individual extract. Thank you. Gupta ma'am, thank you.
Thank you, Kamakshi. Any question?
Ma'am, we are just working on that.
Any idea?
No ma'am, we have just collected the samples and we just sent for those sample for GCMS process so that we can isolate the component which is responsible for antifungal activity.
Excuse me, I have a question. Would you please tell me at what temperature fungus can be grown?
37 degree centigrade.
I think 37 degree Celsius is an optimum temperature for the bacteria.
No, it's also optimum for fungus culture.
Fungus
also. Yes.
Thank you.
Respected chairperson, speaker and all my dear friends, I'll take you into a different world of wildlife, different from the microbial world and now what we heard from my co-presentees. So for my research, I chose a topic which is overgrazing that impacts the ecosystem of Sariska Tiger Reserve. So as we know that India is a very big country encompassing a large number of habitats and ecological niches that is very rich in biodiversity. But the increasing human civilization, which has tried to become very sophisticated and urbanized, it is actually creating a huge impact on the biodiversity. The forest development process is actually slowing down a lot. So for my research topic, I chose a very interesting topic, that is deforestation, which we are naturally we get to observe in large national parks and sanctuaries of India today, and that is overgrazing. Now what is overgrazing? Overgrazing refers to the condition when a particular area's vegetation is overutilized or intensely utilized so that it does not recover. Now today this overgrazing theme has actually become very, very much common. We can get to see it into a large number of national parks and sanctuaries because it has got a large number of environmental impact attributed to it. So with the research study, my aim was to study the impact of overgrazing on ecosystem of Sariska Tiger Reserve. Then, because overgrazing affects both the abiotic and biotic factors which is there inside the core areas of the tiger reserve, and along with that it was to study the wildlife, how the wildlife of the Sariska Tiger Reserve is decreasing day by day. This is the study area. Sariska Tiger Reserve lies in the Alwar district of Rajasthan, and it is a subtropical dry deciduous forest along with thorn forest. It was declared as a tiger reserve in 1951 and then further proved that 1955 was recognized as a tiger reserve. The core area of Sariska Tiger Reserve has four ranges. One is Akbarpur, second is Sariska, third is Talvriksh and fourth is Tehla region. Now the whole four ranges are surrounded by buffer region. The total area of Sariska Tiger Reserve is approximately 866 square kilometers. Now coming to the percentage of land which is covered by forest in Sariska Tiger Reserve. So if from the GPS images we can actually see that most of the area of the Sariska Tiger Reserve is now open forest, and the area which lies in the buffer region, which is pink in color, is actually cropland and fallow land. So basically my intention is to say that most of the area has now turned into fallow lands, which cannot be utilized for any source. The village population in and around the park. So Sariska has around 300 villages which lies in the 5 kilometer radius of the boundary of buffer region. And then there are 11 villages inside the proposed national park, which is the core area 1, one village in core area 2 and two villages in core area 3. Besides, there are 22 villages in the buffer area of the Sariska Tiger Reserve. So in all there are 36 villages. Now besides that, there are 6 grazing camps in core area 1. Coming to the occupation of the villagers, most of the villagers from the graph, as we can see, they are non-workers. So non-workers means they are basically pastoralists or agriculturalists, or they are heavily dependent on the livestock for grazing. Now in the buffer and the core areas of the villages, the occupation of people is either livestock rearing or agriculturalist. 80% of the population are agriculturalists. So you can imagine that most of the people who have the cattle and cattle and animals like goats, camels and buffaloes for livestock rearing, they are totally dependent on the natural resources of the forest for their biotic consumption. Next is the fauna of Sariska. These are the prominent animals which are found in the core areas of the tiger reserve, and the important flora of the forest, which is doe, tendu, hare and bear. So we collected primary and secondary data for the analysis, and these are the pictures which has been taken from the core areas of the forest. We can actually see cattle grazing. Cattle grazing can be clearly seen in the core areas of the region. Along with that, we had to do the biochemical testing of soil and water also. We did the soil and water analysis to exactly find out what is the impact of overgrazing in that region. And the results that we got from the analysis were very different from the WHO standards, which was actually unacceptable in that region. So that actually shows that overgrazing of an area depletes the soil quality, and when it depletes the soil quality, it makes the regeneration of the plants in that region very difficult. Along with that, it also comes in competition with the wildlife of that area. Suppose overgrazing occurs in core region of the tiger reserve, then the wildlife of that area comes in direct competition with the cattle population. So this is the area, the second picture at the bottom is the picture which we got to see in the reserve, and it was supposed to be the area which was the first picture. It should have been like that, but because there is overgrazing in the reserve, we get to see such pictures. Now because it comes in direct competition with the wildlife, there has been an impact on the wildlife population. There has been a tremendous decrease in the population of sambars and sambars, cheetahs, chausingas, all these animals which are found in the core areas. So only highlighting the problems of that area was not our intention. Our intention was also to suggest some measures to the forest department so that they can take up some measures and conserve the educate the villagers in that area to decrease overgrazing in that area. So these were some measures. First is rotational grazing, which is a very important factor. Rotational grazing is taking the livestock from one area to another area and then relieving that first area free for some time, so that regeneration of plants can occur. Then reducing the number of animals on the land. The sustainable approach was management of permanent pastures, integrated livestock development, rotational grazing, and land rehabilitation. And last is reducing human interference, which is very important for conservation of the wildlife habitat, which is artificial and natural barrier, guarding that area, educational awareness of the villagers, proper demarcation, relocation, and livelihood. So these are some references which I have been associated with. So with this, I end my slide. Thank you so much, and let's make this place a better. Let's make this earth a better place to live. Thank you.
Thank you, Neha. Any question from audience?
Are you working with any project funded by government agency?
Actually, I'm working with an NGO which is Raksha, and I'm working there as a research coordinator. So it is not a government funded project. We did it on my own. We did it on our cost.
So you are saying that there is direct competition between the cattle and the grazing animals, wild animals. Have you seen some animals which are dying by, you say that they are not getting food, that's why they are dying. Is it like that?
No, actually we collected our data in the form of primary and secondary data. So primary data was like direct observation and questionnaires from the villagers. So when we went and spoke with the people there, the villagers which were there in the core areas, they themselves told us that earlier, because when their livestock population was less, when the impact of overgrazing was less in that area, they used to get to see more population of sambars, nilgais and chausingas in that area. But with the time, as livestock population has increased in that area, and because the people, they release their livestock, they go and eat the grasses and everything over there. So those people themselves told us that the number of population, the wild population has actually decreased.
Actually, you see the organisms which are surviving there, mm-hmm. I have recently visited, they are looking quite healthy, means food is available. So there is no competition for food. There may be other competition or other problems related.
No, looking healthy is a different point, and the number of the total population of those animals and in that region is different. So if some animal looks healthy, it doesn't actually mean that they are getting a proper food or fodder in that area. We have to, because the survey that we did, we found the exact census. We looked up the census of the population, and we studied the census of 3 to 4 years, and then we came to this conclusion that the population is actually decreasing.
So thank you, Neha. So now I invite to the next speaker, Prem Prakash Ashoka. A comparative analysis of salinity induced in vitro oxidative stress and antioxidative defense response in triticum, Eleuthinae.
Good afternoon. I am representing my PhD work entitled Comparative Analysis of Salinity Induced in Vitro Oxidative Stress and Antioxidative Defense Mechanism in Triticum, Eleuthinae and Pasculum. Salinity.
I think I would suggest you that leave the introduction and just focus on your results at this point. It will be very interesting, I think. So we will give the introduction, then.
Salinity plant with physiological drought induced agriculture. यानी कि पानी होते हुए भी प्लांट पानी को एब्जॉर्ब नहीं कर पा रहा, क्योंकि वाटर पोटेंशियल जो है सॉइल में वो कम हो जाती है और ऑस्मोटिक प्रेशर जो है प्लांट सेल में वो कंपैरेटिवली कम होने की वजह से प्लांट पानी होते हुए भी पानी को अपटेक नहीं कर पाता, जिसकी वजह से फिजियोलॉजिकल ड्रॉट कंडीशन क्रिएट हो जाती है और प्लांट सेल्स में टारगेट प्रेशर रिडक्शन हो जाता है, जिसकी वजह से बहुत ज़्यादा ऑक्सीडेटिव स्ट्रेस क्रिएट हो जाता है, जैसे सेकेंडरी स्ट्रेस। और इस ऑक्सीडेटिव स्ट्रेस के रेस्पॉन्स में प्लांट में एंटी ऑक्सीडेंट एंजाइम्स का फॉर्मेशन एज ए डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म प्लांट प्रोड्यूस करता है। हमने डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म को टेस्ट करने के लिए चार एंजाइम्स की एक्टिविटी को एनालाइज किया था। एसओडी एक्टिविटी वाज मेजर्ड बाय मेथड ऑफ डिंडाइटॉल एंड कैटलेज एक्टिविटी वाज मेजर्ड बाय मेथड ऑफ टेरेनिसी एंड एस्कॉर्बेट पेरोक्सिडेज एक्टिविटी वाज एसेड अकॉर्डिंग टू मेथड। अमाउंट ऑफ क्लोरोफिल वाज ऑल्सो मेजर्ड, क्योंकि स्ट्रेस कंडीशन इंड्यूज होने पर प्लांट में ड्राई वेट रिडक्शन होता है और ड्राई वेट के साथ साथ क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट में भी कमी होती है। और क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट की कमी को हमने एनालाइज किया, जैसे जैसे सेरेनिटी इंड्यूस इंक्रीज हो रही थी वैसे वैसे एंटीऑक्सीडेंट एंजाइम्स की एक्टिविटी इंक्रीज हो रही थी और क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट जो है वो प्लांट में कम हो रहा था। दीज आर रिजल्ट्स। इन पिक्चर्स में शो किया गया है कि जैसे जैसे सेलिनिटी इंक्रीज की जा रही है, सेलिनिटी हमने मैग्नीशियम और कैडमियम मैग्नीशियम क्लोराइड साल्ट को मीडिया में अलग अलग कंसेंट्रेशन में लेकर इंट्रोड्यूस कराया था, और जैसे जैसे सेलिनिटी इंक्रीज की गई वैसे प्लांट की शूट लेंथ और रूट लेंथ में कमी को देखा गया। बीट एलुसाइन और पेस्पलम तीनों में ये कमी देखने को मिली। द एसओडी एक्टिविटी ऑफ थ्री जेनरा अंडर डिफरेंट कंसेंट्रेशन जैसे जैसे सेलिनिटी इंड्यूस की गई वैसे वैसे तीनों ही प्लांट्स में जो एंटीऑक्सीडेंट एंजाइम सुपरऑक्साइड डिसमीटर्स और परऑक्सीडेज की एक्टिविटी जो है वो इंक्रीज हुई, और वही हमें रिजल्ट में भी देखने को मिली। और क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट की साल्ट कंसेंट्रेशन इंक्रीज होने पर क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट में कमी देखने को मिली, और इन सभी एंजाइम एक्टिविटी में एक चीज देखने को मिली कि जितने भी एंजाइम्स थे एंटीऑक्सीडेंट वो सभी में कंटिन्यूसली उनकी एक्टिविटी इंक्रीज हो रही थी, लेकिन कैटलेज क्योंकि ये एक्सपेरिमेंट तीन प्लांट में किया गया था, वीट पेस्पलम एंड इलुसाइन। वीट इज सीरियल एंड पेस्पलम एंड इलुसाइन आर मिलेट प्लांट्स। कैटलेज एंजाइम के अलावा बाकी तीन जो एंजाइम है सुपरऑक्साइड डिसमीटर एस्कॉर्बेट पेरोक्सिडेज और पेरोक्सिडेज की एक्टिविटी जो है वो वीट के कंपैरेटिवली सीरियल्स में ज़्यादा इंक्रीज हो रही थी, जबकि कैटलेज की एक्टिविटी सीरियल्स में यानी कि वीट में ज़्यादा इंक्रीज हो रही थी। यानी कि एंटीऑक्सीडेटिव डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म जो है वीट में, कैटलेज वहाँ पर डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म के लिए काम कर रहा था मेनली, और बाकी अदर जो तीन एंजाइम्स है वो मिलेट्स में हाईली एक्सप्रेस हो रहे थे कंपैरेटिव टू सीरियल्स।
Thank you, Prem Prakash, for giving a very good and quick presentation. And now you can ask one or two questions from the speaker, any you want.
When 50 millimole, 100 millimole, 100 millimole or 150 millimole solution banaye the, or medium mein.
So, thank you, Prem Prakash.
Good afternoon to all respected and wise people present over here. I am Rashmi Swaroop and I am giving a presentation on infringing territories and modified habits of birds, anthropogenic factors at work. I won't take long because I want to just give an idea what I had. Let's start with introduction. arid and semi-arid regions are very unique kind of habitats, which prove to be very demanding to the organisms which come or choose to survive in these regions. Along with the other factors, habitable space is always sparse in arid and semi-arid regions. But the ultimate tendency of biological species to claim new places to exist there and is never discouraged. It leads to overcrowding of the region in respect to space and other vital resources. The most adaptable species tend to advance beyond the usual limits and coexist peacefully. Regardless of how beneficial this coexistence is for nature and evolution, this presents great examples to observe, explore, and research. Humans and urbanization have modified the ecosystems to a great degree, being the most powerful creatures owing to their unlimited potential of their brains. They have forced other species, especially which are close to them, to adapt. Very subtly, this kind of unnatural compulsion is resulting into biodiversity loss. Yet, it is interesting to note that how pretty, glorious and majestic birds that stand next to us in intelligence have adapted and also compromised according to this modified ecosystem. Most of these adaptations are structural adaptations. My methods were the examples of territory infringement either by birds or by humans were noticed and focused observations were made and field notes were prepared. Behavioral adaptations were observed more intricately using Nikon 35x7 binoculars and pictures were secured with the help of Nikon camera or 26x zooming capacity. Observations. Corvids and raptors show special knack toward using utility poles as their nesting platforms. This scenario brings forth a bittersweet fact, which is they need high substrates for their nest, and in today's times there aren't enough trees around. Corvids and raptor nests on electric utility poles can become hazardous for both birds and public. The second example of these adaptation you can see, few smaller perching birds like house sparrow have been found building the nest to unusual places, unusual at least to us. It can be said they can build their nest anywhere they find place. They build nest, be it traffic lights, unused vehicles or abandoned buildings. House sparrow is a correctly named for living and carrying out their life activities in and around human houses. Another example is redecoration of nest takes varied form in varied number of species. Few of the species decorate their nest using plastic. The most apparent reason being that plastic is readily available in today's world, overpowered by human and their interventions. And views based on observations of raptors suggest that by using plastic, bird might be signaling some message like keep out or I'm tough. Other views suggest that it can also be a way of camouflaging their eggs because advertising an activeness does not look right. Yet another example of such adaptation is the use of floating garbage as their floating platforms by aquatic birds. We can see some moorhens, little egrets and large egrets in these pictures. Another example is finding and utilizing temporary foraging opportunities found by human intervention. These foraging opportunities can be found in the parks, in farm areas and field areas. You can see cattle egrets, spoonbill and Indian pond heron foraging in such places. They also use man-made structures as their hideouts, both from their prey and predators. This is the picture from Vishram Sthali, Anasagar Lake Ajmer, around Anasagar Lake Ajmer, which is now completely submerged, and birds are taking advantage of that. What people are doing elsewhere? This is the photograph from Nebraska Game Parks, where they are standing up an alternative nesting platform for ospreys. It shows how much they care. This avoids the osprey infrastructural conflicts. Signboards they have put up to aware common people about the sensitive avian biodiversity around the area. This is to show that we care and to request that others should care too. We can see they have abandoned an ash tree also because there were blue tits nesting over there. I have drawn a conclusion that few bird species have changed their habits in respect to the environment manipulated by human beings, such artificial stress on these species should be minimized. It will help in holding back them from invading into human areas. This is important for human health and safety, reducing property damage, and most importantly, this is the only way by which accelerating biodiversity loss can be prevented. What should we do? Whenever the interests of human being and wildlife do not coincide, we tend to take a rather forceful approach, which is not fair enough because we were the ones who first invaded and destroyed other species' natural habitats. It is the high time that while understanding our social responsibility, we also start taking care of responsibilities toward our natural environment and biodiversity. What's the point? The point is simple, that birds cannot put up a board like no trespassing or something. So we have to do this for them. I want to thank these people and thank you so much.
So thank you, Rashmi. So, any questions? No questions?
Thank you.
So, at last, I would like to thank all the speakers for giving a nice presentations from the diversity of the higher plant, medicinal plants, and their usage by using the antimicrobial activities and also the animal biodiversity. So this was a very interesting technical session combining so many different aspects of the biodiversity. So I would also like to thank to the organizer of the conference for giving opportunity to me as act as a chairperson. Thank you very much.
Present floral greetings and a token of our appreciation to Professor Amla Batra. Thank you, sir. Professor Amla Batra is the former head, Department of Botany, coordinator, PG courses in biotechnology, principal, Maharani's College, University of Rajasthan. As a university teacher, she has excelled in scientific field. On the account of her qualities, she has been honored with several titles such as the most lovable principal and the protoplast lady to request Professor Pradeep Bhatnagar to accord floral greetings and a token of our appreciation to the speakers. Namaskar. Thank you, sir. May I now request the chairperson to take over the session.
Good afternoon, senior professors, dean of the institute, not institute, the university, and the professors who have traveled from different corners of the nation, India. There are two main speakers right now, the guest speakers, and then the youngsters would come. And my dear youngsters, I'm very happy to be here and thank you so much for having invited me over, plus given me a chance to be the chairperson in one of the sessions. I'm really delighted on the topic chosen for the seminar, which is a current topic. We all know it. We are facing a lot of problems because of the burgeoning population and overgrazing, like the last lecture we heard was about overgrazing. So everything is becoming imbalanced in life. And if this continues, as Gandhiji said that time, you know, you all know his phrase, that we have everything for our need, but we don't have for our greed. So it's very important to stop somewhere and keep the balance in our lives. As far as ecosystem is concerned, or the habitat is concerned, environment is concerned, we should be really, really concerned about it. And on the top of it, we should be really concerned about the biodiversity, which we are losing every single day. Okay, with this I stop here, and we are going to hear very interesting lectures, invited lectures. First lecture is by Professor K.C. Sharma. He has been the former Vice Chancellor, and presently he is Professor in Head Department of Environmental Science, Dean School of Earth Sciences, Dean Academic, Central University of Rajasthan. He has held lots of important positions. Some of them are Professor Environmental Science at Ajmer University, Vice Chancellor, MDS University, Ajmer, Director Research, Dean Faculty of Science, MDS University, Ajmer, and Member SEAC 2008-11. So you can see he's published lots of papers, he has been into teaching, research and administration all the time at the same time. That is wonderful. You learn from such people a lot, because they are involved not only in academics but in research at the same time and in administration. So, you know, this is especially for youngsters to learn, you know, because how to divide your time. Time is very important, and how he has been utilizing his time in three great faculties, you know, of his life, and balancing them, that is very important. That reminds me, very small thing, because youngsters are here, so I would really like to put this phrase in front of you. Waqt aayega, waqt jayega. Waqt ko waqt se samal ke rakhna, ye waqt hi ek din be waqt kaam aayega. So, you know, you have to really catch this time, and this time is going to help you to fulfill your dreams in life. Coming back to his, you know, achievements, he has had 32, around more than 32, you know, research scholars who has done their PhD under him, and still a lot of people, more than 36 people, students have done their MPhil under him. He's published lots and lots of papers, number is around a century, you know. Then projects, he has completed lots of projects, national projects and international projects, and what to talk of seminars and symposia, workshops, they have been innumerable in his life. Research specialization, he has got plant pathology, microbiology, environmental microbiology, mycology. With this, I think he's a member of many journals, editor to many journals, referee to paper, you know, referee to many international journals for the papers, for the publication. With this, I think, is enough. Next one I'll speak when she finishes, okay? So now I would request Professor K.C. Sharma to come on the dais and give his lecture. I hope that people, you would restrict, you know, to time. I request you, because we are already being delayed by some time. Thank you so much.